Hello everyone. In this lesson, we're going to learn about NumPy arrays. Now, in past lessons, we've learned about some different built-in Python data structures, such as lists, tuples, dictionaries, and sets. Now, these are useful for general purposes, but for data analysis, we'd like some more specific functionality, such as being able to do element-wise mathematics and doing math with tables or 2D arrays that are essentially matrices. Now, a NumPy array is actually very similar to a list. It just stores a sequence of objects, but it also has some differences. A list is a heterogeneous data structure, meaning it can store items of different types. A NumPy array is a homogeneous data structure, meaning it can only store data of the same type. Another difference is that NumPy arrays have a dimension to them, so they can be one-dimensional, which is essentially the same as a normal list, but they can also be two-dimensional to hold, say, a table of values or a matrix, or you can even make them three-dimensional or greater depending on what your application is. So to gain access to NumPy arrays, you first need to import the NumPy package. If you have that installed on your system, all you need to do is run import numpy, and we usually give it the shorthand name np, so import numpy is np, means we'll be able to access all the numpy functions with this np nickname. Now this Kaggle kernel environment I'm using to do these lessons has numpy installed by default. If you already have a Python installation but you don't have numpy, you can probably install it by pulling up a command line and running something like pip install numpy. But if you're installing Python for the first time on a local machine, I recommend installing the Anaconda distribution of Python, which will come with a lot of the useful data science packages that you'll want to use, including NumPy. But now that we've imported NumPy, let's go ahead and start learning how to use it. So to create a NumPy array, you can pass a list into the numpy.array function. So here we're defining a new list, my list, just has four values. And now we're going to turn it into a NumPy array. So to do that, we're going to say np.array, that's numpy.array, and then we pass the list in as the argument. And if we check the type of my array, it will show that it is indeed a NumPy array, or nd array is what they're called. If you would like to construct a NumPy array with more than one dimension, you can simply pass in a comma-separated list of the different lists that contain the data you want. So here we're going to define a second list, and now we're going to make a two-dimensional array constructed by a list of lists. So here we're passing to numpy.array the list that we want to construct the dimensions with, and within the list is each of the sublists. So here is the first list we made earlier and the second one, and this will create a 2D array. Now, a NumPy array is defined by the number of dimensions it has and the size of each of those dimensions, and you can check that with the dot shape attribute of the array. So if we call the name of the array here we just defined earlier dot shape, that will tell us what the size of each dimension is. So this NumPy array is 2 by 4. And we can see above that means it had 2 rows and 4 columns. You can also check the total number of items in a NumPy array with the dot size attribute. So here if we run dot size on our 2 by 4 array, we get 8. And you can also calculate this easily just by multiplying all the different dimensions together, but dot size is just a quicker way of doing that. Then you can check the type of data held in a NumPy array with the .dtype attribute. So here we're going to check the type of object we're dealing with. So here we can see the array we're working with is int64. That means it's a 64-bit integer. NumPy does come with a few special array creation functions that can be handy to make commonly used arrays. So we will look at some of those. If you want to make an identity matrix, which is a matrix filled with ones across the diagonal, you can do that with the np.identity function, and then you pass in the argument n to specify the dimensions. And in this case, it's going to make a square array, so the 5 means it's going to be 5 by 5. So if we run that, we get a 5 by 5 matrix with ones along the diagonal. If you want to create a matrix filled with ones, you can use np.ones to accomplish that. So if we say np.ones, then we just pass in the shape of the array we want. In this case, we're going to make a 2 by 4 matrix or array. That's what we get there. So it's filled with ones. You can do the same thing with zeros with np.zeros. So here we'll make another one, but we'll make it 4x6 and another matrix, and it's filled with zeros. NumPy arrays offer similar indexing and slicing operations to Python lists, but we'll just go through and review what some of those are. So here we're going to make a new NumPy array, and if we want to index into this array and get a specific value, say the value at index 3, we just write the name of the array, and in square brackets we put the index where we want to get the value. In this case, the index 3 gets us the number 4, because in Python the indices start at 0. We can also slice an array just like a list. So here we're saying start at index 3 and get us everything till the end. That's what the colon says. You can also do the same slicing trick, reversing lists. You can do that with arrays as well. So if you do colon colon negative 1, that's saying slice the entire array, but do it backwards. That's what the negative 1 is saying. So that essentially reverses the array. Now we'll look at indexing into a two-dimensional array. So we're going to make a new 2D array here that's just numbers from 1 to 18, but in three different rows. And to index into a 2D array, you use the same kind of index construction, except you need now a comma-separated list. In this case, only two items are needed to specify each dimension. So first we write what row we want to access. The one is specifying row. And then we specify which column we want to access. So that's the 4. So in this case, we're saying we want to get the item in row 1, column 4. And since it's 0 indexed again, row 1 is actually not this row, that's row 0. Row 1 is this row, and then item 4 is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 11. So that's the result we get here. And you can also do slicing with two dimensions. We won't go too much into that, but it is something you can do if you want to slice out a given segment of an array. And you can also use our reversing trick that we used on the one-dimensional array to essentially reverse a 2D array by just putting it twice. So here we're doing colon colon minus 1, comma colon colon minus 1 again, which is basically able to reverse both dimensions of the array and gets us the array in backwards order. Now the NumPy package contains different functions that allow you to change arrays after they're created. One of those is the reshape function. Reshape allows you to take an existing array and change around the dimensions. So for instance, we can take this array we have above, which is a 3x6 array, and we can change that into, say, a 6x3 array by using reshape. So we'll show how to do that here. We're going to say np.reshape. Then first we're going to pass in the array we're reshaping, and then we want to reshape it into this new shape equals a 6x3 instead of our previous dimensions 3x6. So when you run that, we essentially made a tall array now with 6 rows and 3 columns instead of 3 rows and 6 columns. You can also take a multi-dimensional array and unravel it into a one-dimensional version of itself with the .ravel method. So we'll show how to do that. We're going to say np.ravel. We're going to pass in the array we want to unravel, so that's our 2D array again. And then you use this extra argument order to specify how you want to unravel it. In this case, we want to unravel by the rows because our numbers were in ascending order by row. And if you want to unravel by columns instead, you just set order to F, which is Fortran style unraveling. I'm not exactly sure why it's C in Fortran style. I do not know those languages very well, so I'm not sure why that is, but that is the arguments you need to do what you need to do. An alternative way of doing the same thing essentially is using the dot flatten function. So here we can say 2D array dot flatten, and that will return a copy of the 2D array flattened into a 1D array. To get the transpose of a 2D NumPy array, you use the dot t method. What that does is essentially turn the rows into columns and the columns into rows. You can also flip a 2D array horizontally or vertically using dot flip up down UD or dot flip LR, which stands for left right. You can also rotate 2D arrays using dot rot 90, and the argument K specifies how many times to carry out the rotation. So in this case, we're only rotating by 90 degrees once, but you could do that multiple times to get different rotations. You can also shift numbers within a 2D array using dot roll. So we'll show how to do that here. We're going to say np.roll. We'll take our array, We're going to say we want to shift elements by 2, and then axis specifies along either rows or columns. So axis 1 is saying we want to shift everything over by 2 along the rows. So, and that will wrap around. So the 1 used to be in the 0 position, but we shifted it over by 2. And then the 6 that used to be over here was shifted off the end and back over here. So we shifted all the rows over by 2 like that. And if we had specified, and if you want to shift the entire array without observing rows and columns, you want to leave the axis argument blank. So in this case, if we say shift 2, but we don't have an axis at all, it's going to shift all the numbers along the rows and wrap around at the end. So in this case, the 1 is still shifted over 2, but instead of being shifted within its own row, it's being shifted within the entire array. So the 18 that used to be at the end is shifted off the end and then goes to the beginning. And finally, if you have 2 NumPy arrays and you want to concatenate them together, you can use the dot concatenate function. So here we're going to make another array to join to our existing one above. It's just going to be some additional numbers here. That's going to be a 3x3 array. And to do that, we say np.concatenate, and then we pass in the 2 arrays we want to join inside of a tuple. So here's the first array, here's the second array, and then you specify axis to say along which axis do you want to do the concatenation. So we're saying we want to take this second array and put it on the right-hand side. Essentially, we want to put it on the rows is what this is saying. And so when we run this, it is pasting this 3x3 array we just made onto the right-hand side of our existing array that we had, essentially making an array with longer rows. Now note that when you do a concatenation like this, you need to do one where the dimensions match up properly to make a valid matrix. So in this case, it worked because our original array had 3 rows and the thing we were adding to it had 3 rows, and we were concatenating them across rows. So the number of rows matched up, which allowed us to do that. If we say tried to do it along the columns, well, this only has 3 columns and this one has 6 columns. You can't put 3 columns into 6 columns. That doesn't create a valid matrix. Now, most of what we've shown so far are things similar to what you could do with two-dimensional lists in Python. The real strength of NumPy arrays is that they allow you to do math operations in an element-wise fashion, and the way they're implemented under the hood makes those math operations much faster than they would be if you tried to do something similar using lists. So just go through and show the various basic math operations you can do with NumPy arrays that are going to be considerably more efficient than if you were to do the same thing with lists for the most part. So the nice thing about NumPy arrays is they do things element-wise. So if you want to do additions or add scalar values, it will do that to every item in the whole array by default. So for instance, if we took our array from earlier and we wanted to add 100 to every single value in the whole array, all we have to do is take the array and say plus 100, and it will know it's supposed to add 100 to every element without having to do any kind of explicit for loop. So when we run that, we see the same array, but everything has been increased by 100. And similarly, we can subtract 100. We could multiply the whole thing by 2 at every element. Or we could say do exponentiation. So we're going to take the whole array and square everything in it. You can take the modulus by using percent. If you do modulus 2, that will show you which numbers are odd and which are even. And the really nice thing is that if you have 2 NumPy arrays of the same dimension, you can actually do the same sort of element-wise operations directly with them to add the values or subtract the values within the arrays. So here we're going to define a new 2x2 array, and then we're just going to add it to itself. So the array is only going to contain the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4. But if we add it to itself, each number is being added to the same number in its own positions. So 1 is being added to 1 to get 2. 2 is being added to 2 to get 4, etc. And if we say subtracted small array from itself, well, everything would be 0 because it's doing it in an element-wise fashion. And if we say multiplied it by itself, everything would end up being squared. And if we use exponentiation, well, every item in small array would be raised to the power of itself. So this is 1 to the 1, 2 to the 2, 3 to the 3, and 4 to the 4. NumPy arrays also support a lot of named math functions that can get you statistics and other useful values. So I'll show how to use some of those. If you use np.mean, that will get you the mean or average of an array. If you include an axis argument to .mean, it will give you the average but along the given axis instead of the whole thing. So here we're passing in our 2D array and we're saying we want the means but across the rows. So we're going to see the average for each row in that case. You can use np.std to find standard deviations. You can get the sum of items in an array with .sum. Again, you can do that across axes. So this will give us the sum across all the rows. And if we wanted to get the sum across the columns, we can just pass axis equals 0 to do that. You can take the log of all the items in a NumPy array with np.log. You can do square roots with np.sqrt. If you need to do dot products, you can do that with np.dot. That will take two arrays, multiply all the elements within them element-wise, and then add them all together, resulting in a single scalar value at the end of that. So here we're going to slice our 2D array, taking the first row and the second row, and we're just going to get the dot product of those two rows. Now, if you use np.dot on two NumPy arrays that are not one-dimensional, it will instead perform a matrix multiplication instead of a dot product. So if we wanted to do a matrix multiply with our small 2x2 array with itself, we could say np.dot and then just pass in the small array twice, and this is the result of multiplying that 2D matrix by itself. Now the NumPy package does include more advanced linear algebra functions should you need them. There's a hyperlink here. I will leave a link to this in the description below. So to wrap up this lesson, NumPy arrays provide a useful data structure for working with data that allows for efficient mathematical operations that are a lot nicer to work with than built-in Python data structures such as lists, and they lend themselves more naturally to working with data that's in more than one dimension. That said, real-world data that you're going to encounter will often contain data of more than one type. So we learned at the beginning of the lesson that NumPy arrays are homogeneous data objects, so they can only contain data of one type. But that's not ideal for working with different types of data sets, because we're often going to have something with, say, integers and character strings and maybe dates and other types of data. So a NumPy array isn't able to store all those different things all at once. So we need something else to do that when we're trying to work with data. So in the next lesson, we're going to learn about pandas data frames. Data frames are a powerful data container that mirror the structure of data tables you might find in databases and spreadsheet programs like Microsoft Excel that make it much easier to work with data within Python. So thanks for watching, and I'll see you again next time.